welcome Matt Wrack to the podium. Matt is, has been a firefighter for many years in his life, but he's now the elected General Secretary of the Fire Brigades Union. So I'll hand over to Matt Wrack.
Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, we in the Fire Brigade Union have a very particular interest in what happened at Grenfell Tower. It was our members who were asked to go into that building to try to save lives. Almost to a man and a woman, every single firefighter going up those stairs that night were members of our union, the Fire Brigade Union. And every time I think about it, it still shocks me. I was a firefighter in this part of the world for more than two decades. I've attended many fires in tower blocks. I looked at that tower block and, like firefighters all over the world indeed, wondered how the hell is anyone going to do anything in that inferno. Firefighters have procedures, training and equipment to allow them to go into fires and to put fires out. But the fire at Grenfell Tower was on such a scale that it was impossible to apply any procedures and policies that would allow firefighters to do their job under normal circumstances. And I've spoken to very senior officers in the London Fire Brigade, and I don't criticise them for any of the decisions they took that night. But everyone there was very well aware that normal practice and procedure could not be followed, and therefore people were very deliberately and very consciously putting their own lives at risk in order to try to save other people's lives. And it is still remarkable to me the scale of what they did achieve despite the horrendous loss of life. So we have a very personal interest in getting to the bottom of how a fire that should never have happened did nevertheless happen. And we have raised the question of tower block safety over many years, following the deaths of our own members in tower block fires, including in tower block fires following refurbishment. And in fact, as far ago as 2006, I spoke in the House of Commons Select Committee expressing concern about what we described in 2006 as a postcode lottery in terms of how fire services plan to respond to fires in residential blocks of flats. And it does seem to me we lost two firefighters on two different occasions at about that time. And one of the shocking things is if we die in small numbers, it seems that people ignore it. And we cannot allow them to ignore this occasion. So we have a very direct and personal interest as firefighters in this, but we have a much wider interest. As a union, we're part of a wider movement. We're part of the labour movement, the trade union movements, and we want to see justice for the residents and the survivors of Grenfell Tower. And we want to see decent and safe housing for everybody, whether they're members of our union or not. And that's why we've fought over many years for improved workplace safety. That's why we've campaigned on the question of what furniture we have in our home to try and make people's homes safer. We want the best possible safety that there is. And we want justice across our society. And one thing, I've been to Grenfell many times since the fire, including on the day it was still going on, including the day on which the Prime Minister attended and the day on which Jeremy Corbyn attended. Two stark and contrasting visits to that incident, including the response of the people fighting the fire, by the way. But one thing that struck me and still strikes me, and Eileen mentioned it, is the utter and complete failure of authority at local and at national level to do anything remotely like what was needed to look after people who had been through that horror. And it is staggering the incompetence, the ineptitude, the stupidity, and probably the corruption of these people to ignore on such a scale as to allow this to happen, and then to ignore the impact on that community once it had happened. And thank God for the local community who did come together in such a remarkable way to look after each other. And they deserve the praise and support of all of us. just into the fire service is just one small part of this, but I think it does nevertheless tell a story. The fire service I joined in 1983, and I started at Silvertown Fire Station, now closed, and I spent most of my time at Kingsland Fire Station, now closed. And the fire service I joined had national standards of fire cover. It had a national body that set standards about equipment, training, procedures, and research, all things which were abolished some years ago. We have no publicly funded research on fire matters in the UK anymore. So it's not surprising, perhaps, that nobody was spotting what the hell was going on with this cladding that was being applied to tower blocks all across the country. We have, and I said it, people have asked whether this is related to austerity. Clearly it is related to austerity, but I have to be very clear, it predates the coalition government. It's a 30-year programme of deregulation and privatisation that has created the situation when you attack council housing over more than three decades, when you attack the public sector over more than three decades, when in our own sector, you or in local government, you attack and privatise building control, the people who say whether buildings are safe or not, whether you, in the fire risk assessment, have no requirement to meet any standards at all. You can set yourself up as a fire risk assessor by going on a website and setting yourself up advertising for work. I'm not saying they all do, but some people certainly do. We have another inquest, again involving one of our own members, where the fire risk assessor in a commercial premises had no qualifications whatsoever. And then when the fire service, who are supposed to then audit these fire risk assessments, specialist teams, not the people you see riding on fire engines generally, but specialist, highly trained people within the fire service, we have lost something like two-thirds of them since 2005. And then it's not surprising then that the number, either, there's two things can happen, either the quality or the quantity of those inspections must decline, or both. And I suspect that in reality both of them have happened. And then when, as I say, fire research is completely abolished in the UK, you end up with a position where those people arguing for safety are actually run into a brick wall, because those in central government advising ministers, and then the ministers taking decisions, listen in reality to the developers and the construction industry, not to those advocating public safety and decent housing. That's the regime under which we have been living for a very long time. The truth is, there is nothing inherently dangerous about high-rise living. There are very wealthy people all across the world who live in very well-designed and well-built high-rise residential blocks. And indeed, these blocks of flats were designed by architects who built fire protection into the construction of those blocks. But things have happened since where less attention has been paid to that. Because if you follow the regeneration of Grenfell Tower and the surrounding estates, the whole thing was about what a blot on the landscape Grenfell Tower was, not for the residents living within it, but for the surrounding area. And mention being made of social housing bringing down the property values in that borough. What an utter sickening disgrace that that's the sort of background to this horror. So we have a world where in reality we have developers versus democracy, and we have to lead the battle now for democracy. And I'll finish on just a couple of points, echoing something that Eileen said. We're in East London. I lived here for many years of my life, and we also have some tremendous traditions here in the East End of people, tenants, coming together to fight appalling housing conditions, and in the 1930s and beyond, built mass tenants' organisations that fought for decent conditions. And we have to rebuild that movement today. And it has to link up with workers in local governments, workers in the construction industry, workers in the fire risk. None of us delivering those services or those construction projects have any interest in cutting corners. It is the search, endless search for profit, that leads people to cut corners and reduce standards in terms of housing and public safety. So I'll finish on this. Without thought and organisation and struggle, then we won't change anything. But with thought and organisation and struggle, we can change everything. Thank you very much. Specific questions that came up on the they do raise interesting broader points on the question of how many people died. I mean, I will make this point that I think there are some very real practical problems that arise in terms of identifying. I've met the disaster victim identification team, which is a police team, and I've got no doubt that they are very dedicated specialists in that field, and there are huge problems in just in terms of the scale of the utter destruction in that building. So whether there is political management for that, I don't know, but I do know that I'm very confident that there is a very real problem in terms of getting to those facts. On the question of private blocks, it raises again an interesting point. Fire safety responsibilities rest with the owner or occupier of that building. I think in Grenfell Tower, in the inquiry, we'll find an argument on who that actually is. Is it the council, is it the arm's length management, or I suspect people will try and push off the responsibility at that point. So in private blocks, it rests with the owner of that private block. But it does raise another point about national and local government. At the Local Government Association conference recently, the Secretary of State for Communities and Local Government very clearly said, this is a failure of local government. I.e., there is an attempt by central government to pass it. Now, I've got no time for Kensington and Chelsea, or actually many other local authorities across the country, but this is an attempt by central government to say, you can get them lot, we'll give you a few scalps at that level, but don't come for any of us. And we have to make sure this inquiry systematically goes, who gave the advice, who made the decisions at every step of the way. On the question of people asked about cladding and sprinklers, and we're part of this is the world we live in, the National Sprinkler Network, and we broadly support sprinklers. We are against the downgrading of sprinkler advice in schools. Sprinklers may, however, not be the only part. It may be part of the solution, but not all of the solution, because the truth is, cladding is only part of the problem. The question is, what cladding is applied? How is it applied? It raises other questions about the regime. People mentioned prison, and if people need to go to prison, so be it. But if this ends up with a subcontractor of a subcontractor of a subcontractor of a subcontractor paying the price because they haven't been trained, that to me avoids the whole issue of who created the system of subcontracting in the first place. And I suppose the final point for me, someone asked, is this the tipping point? Well, I hope it is the tipping point. It needs to be the tipping point.